क्योंकि टॉपिक बड़ा होता है, खत्म नहीं होता उतने समय। सो टुडेज टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन इज माइक्रोबायोलॉजी ऑफ मिल्क पाउडर। सो वी हैव ऑलरेडी स्टडीड अबाउट क्रीम, बटर, देन आइसक्रीम, कॉन्सेंट्रेटेड मिल्क प्रोडक्ट्स लाइक स्वीट एंड कंडेंस मिल्क एंड एवोपरेटेड मिल्क। एंड टूडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट माइक्रोबायोलॉजी ऑफ मिल्क पाउडर, हाउ डिफरेंट टाइप ऑफ मिल्क पाउडर्स आर प्रोड्यूस, वॉट इज द different processes of manufacturing of these products, then what is the composition of different type of milk powders, then what are the microbiological significance of different stages of manufacturing operation, and what are the different type of spoilages problem, as well as what type of different kind of pathogens are transmitted through different type of milk powder. So first of all, it is important to know that how it is produced. So it is mainly produced by desiccation of, of different type of milk, either skim milk or whole milk, or sometimes, especially in case of dairy whitener, people are using some amount of sugar as well as some other compounds from outside. So, in most of the cases, it depends upon the degree of concentration. And what is happening in that? Nearly whole of the moisture is removed and only 3 to 4% moisture remain in the product. So, after producing this product, you can transport it from one place to another place. It is less perishable. And it requires less space for packaging, and ultimately it will improve the shelf life of your milk. And whenever you want, you can constitute it and get a milk for further use. So why it is produced and what are the requirements of producing these kind of milk powders? So whenever excessive milk is there, especially in flush season, we are forced to convert our milk into different kind of milk powder. And in this process, you can easily conserve the natural characteristic of fresh milk. And ultimately, you will get a dependable keeping quality of finished product. Because you can keep your powder for a longer period, because the moisture level is, maximum moisture level is about 4%, and reduction in volume, and at the same time it will ease to transport. Then it also provide a product to be used in different type of milk products like ice cream making, or if you want some other product manufacturing related to dairy, you can go with this different kind of milk powder. So what are the different type of milk powders generally prepared? Whole milk powder, skim milk powder, in fat foods, malted milk foods, dairy whitener, dried cream, dried butter, dried ice cream mix, dried sweetened condensed milk, then dried whey, buttermilk powder, cheese powder, khoa powder, chana powder, Srikhand powder, dry sodium caseinate, and nowadays people are also manufacturing lactose, whey protein concentrate in our dairy industry. So all these products can be prepared with this drying technology. So what is happening in this? As all of you know, that milk is highly perishable in nature, so it is very important to preserve it. So just after collecting, or you can say just after procurement, first and foremost thing is to lower down its temperature. So you have to give a chilling, treatment to your milk just to preserve it below 4 degrees centigrade, and you are doing this practice or following this practice just to restrict the growth and activity of microorganisms. And in drying is the most important method of preservation, as I have told you people. And what are the advantage of this technique? It is possible to convert the milk to powder without any loss of nutritive value. This is very important, because you are conserving your natural nutritional qualities of milk as well as the nutritive values of your milk. And that is one disadvantage of different kind of drying technique, that it requires a lot of energy, and no other product processing in the dairy industry requires higher energy than this product, if you talk in terms of per ton of final produce. So you can well imagine the condition. No doubt it is a costly affair, and it requires a lot of energy for converting milk into milk powder. But it nowadays a number of different type of dairy industry, either they are of middle size or bigger size, they all are involved in producing their surplus milk, and they are involved in converting their raw milk in different type of powder product, especially in flush season. So this is the composition of whole milk, SMP, skim milk powder, as well as WMP. So just by going through this, what is the composition of whole milk? This is given here. Then SMP composition in this. And at the same time, the whole milk powder composition is given here. The fat percentage, which is very important, that should not be less than 26% in case of whole milk powder, and it should not be more than 1.5% fat in case of SMP. You can see the moisture level in both the product, that is in between, or you can say it is below, it should be below 4% level. And at the same time, as content is higher in case of SMP, and it is lower in case of WMP. And in dairy industry, mainly we are using two methods for drying purposes. That is a spray drying method as well as drum drying method. So where you can use these dried milk powders? So it is mainly used for manufacturing of baked products, snacks, soups, then cheese milk extension powder is added to local fresh milk to increase the yield of cheese. So just by adding some amount of milk powder, you can improve or increase the yield of your final product, that is cheese. You can also use it in chocolate and confectionery industries, then for preparation of different types of sweets as well as dairy desserts, you can use different type of dried milk powders. Direct consumer and household use, you can use this product just after reconstitution. You can utilize it as a fluid milk. Then for the preparation of ice cream, baby food, infant formulas, and it is a nutritional product for immunocompromised persons, invalids, athletes, hospitals, etc. People are using. Then recombine fresh UHT, evaporated and sweetened condensed milk. You can use these products. Thereafter, recombine cheeses, mainly soft or fresh. Then recombine coffee and whipping creams. And recombine yogurt and other fermented dairy product. You can utilize these milk dried milk powders. So something about the milk powder. What is happening in that? Milk powder manufacturing is a process carried out on large scale. A very big plant is required, manufacturing unit is required. Generally, in India, all the milk processing unit or drying unit having capacity is more than 10 ton per day. And now, most of the plant recently started manufacturing of dried milk, they are having capacity more than 30 tons. So you can well imagine the condition that it is generally carried out in large scale. And what is happening in that? We have to remove the moisture from it in very hygienic condition. And our main aim is to retain its original color, flavor, solubility, nutritional values. So automatically, if you want to achieve all these characteristics in your product, you have to go for this particular technology. So what is happening in that? Whatever water is there in milk, that will be removed after boiling under reduced pressure condition and at low temperature. And condensed milk will be prepared. And thereafter, this condensed milk will be sprayed in a fine mist into hot air to remove further moisture and to produce milk powder. And this whole process will be completed inside a spray drying chamber. So what is happening in case of whole milk? As all of you know that whole milk contains about 87% water and skim milk contains 91% water, and ultimately 13 kg of whole milk powder or 7 kg of skim milk powder can be produced by using 100 liter of whole milk as well as skim milk respectively. Again, here I have given you the composition of different type of dried milk powders. In this table, I have tried to give you the comparative typical composition of different type of dried milks. Here, non-fat, dry milk, dry whole milk, and dry buttermilk composition is given. So simply you have to go through this table. What is the major differences between all these products? And in all cases, you will see the protein percentage is very high, and fat percentage in case of skim milk powder, it is very low. And the minimum level for whole milk powder, it is more than 26. As all of you know about the compositional variation in dairy technology courses and in dairy chemistry courses. Now some of the BIS specification for different type of milk powders. Here in this case, the corresponding BIS number is already given here. So the composition of general whole milk powder is about moisture level is 4% maximum. Then total milk solid 96%, that is minimum. Then fat percentage by mass, it is 26. And insolubility index, that is very important thing. And you have to check it for each and every samples collected from different sources at different point. And total as content is maximum limit is 7.3, tetrable acidity is 1.2. And these are the microbiological standard of whole milk powder. At the same time, partly skim milk composition, skim milk powder is given here, which is generally used for manufacturing of different kind of bakery items or some type of confectionery items. Now in the next table, there are generally two grade powders is manufactured in different type of dairy industry. First one is a standard grade and second one is extra grade. So in a standard grade, you can see the composition, 4% fat maximum, 96% total solid, that is minimum. Milk fat is 0.1, milk fat percentage by mass maximum 1.5%. Then insolubility index, if you talk about insolubility index in case of roller dried, it is 15, and a spray dried case, it is 1.5. Total as percentage by mass is given 8.2%, and bacterial count is maximum is 50,000, and coliform count absent per 0.1 gram. And at the same time, people are manufacturing extra grade powder, especially when they have to send their product to the world market. For export purposes, people are getting license of extra grade, and they are preparing it in very hygienic condition. And sometimes what the thing generally happen with a small industry, they are taking high acidity milk and they are neutralizing it with the help of sodium hydroxide. In that case, the lactate content, which is mentioned here, that is milligram in gram maximum per 100 gram, that is 1.5%. If you are manufacturing a milk powder, a particular type of milk powder, which is already neutralized by caustic soda, automatically the you just can't get this level of lactate content. It will increase in your final product. So a very good quality of raw milk is required when you are producing extra grade powder. And the specification and at the same time, BIS number is mentioned here in different tables for different type of milk powders. So what is happening in drying process? As all of you know, when you desiccate your product or when you remove moisture from your milk, it will reduce the water activity level. And what is happening due to this? It will destroy the condition or the lowering down of moisture level in your milk powder that will destroy pathogenic and spoilizes microorganisms. And at the same time, whatever enzymes present in the system, that will be inactivated. And heating, drying, induced chemical interaction leading to the reduction of oxidation reduction potential, which helps in extending the shelf life of dried milk powder under the ambient storage condition. You have already idea that a number of different type of factors are there which are responsible for growth and activity of different type of microorganisms in your milk powder. So here, just by reducing your moisture level, you oxidation reduction potential will be reduced, and automatically it will improve the shelf life of your product when you are storing it at room temperature or you are storing it at ambient temperature. So dried milk powder made from whole milk or skim milk, it is dehydrated to about 97% by the spray drying or vacuum drying, and it sold good shelf life, highly hygroscopic in nature, and can be reconstituted to fluid milk for further use. So these are the characteristics of your final product. And skim, in case of a skim milk powder, it is produced by removing water from pasteurized skim milk, and it contains 4% or less moisture by weight and 1.5% or less milk fat. And a minimum milk protein content is 34%. So just by removing your moisture from the system, you can improve the shelf life of your product. You can also conserve the nutrients present in that, and the you will improve the keeping quality of your product. Now, the manufacturing operation, what are the things you have to do during the manufacturing operation? So first of all, cooling to 4 degrees centigrade, whatever milk you are receiving, and must have a good chemical, bacteriological and organoleptic quality. And it should be free from antibiotic and pesticide. Then only you can produce a very good quality of final product. And tritratables acidity should not be more than 0.15%. And thereafter, you have to go for clarification process by centrifugation or filtration. And before manufacturing, going for manufacturing, you have to standardize your silo, and you have to adjust the ratio of fat as well as total solid present in that. Thereafter, first of all, if you talk about the condensing unit, you must have idea about the high heater, what temperature you are maintaining, and what condition is there inside your condensing unit. Generally, people are using multiple effect evaporating system, and people are using 75 degrees centigrade to 120 degrees centigrade for a specific time that is few seconds to few minutes, and depending upon the type and quality of your raw meal. Then what is happening in that? This preheating or heating treatment, they simply causes a controlled denaturation of whey proteins in the milk, and at the same time, it will destroy the bacteria or mold or is whatever contaminating microbes are there in the system, as well as it inactivates enzymes and generate natural antioxidants. And at the same time, it is very important to give heat stability to your milk. So the exact heating holding time depends upon the type of product and its intended end use. Sometimes people are in use of high heat treated milk powder. Sometimes low heat treated powder is required for different purposes. Automatically, you have to maintain a temperature of high heater as per the qualities required in your final product. So the preheating methods are direct via heat exchanger or indirect via heat exchanger or direct via steam injection or infusion into the product system. And sometimes people are using a combination of these two for getting more effective result. So here I have given you the flow diagram of manufacturing process. Raw milk separation, thereafter pasteurization or heat treatment is given, whatever heat treatment required for producing a typical type of end product. Thereafter, preheating, evaporation, spray dryer, primarily drying is done, then secondary drying. In some cases, what people are doing, if you want to produce a product with good instantization ability or instant product, if you want to produce automatically, you have to go for secondary drying process or agglomeration processes, and that process is mainly by using fluidized bed dryers, and thereafter cooling of the product and packaging will be done in desired shape. And in case of this roller drying process, what we are doing, same filtration, clarification, separation of is done depending upon the type you want to prepare. Thereafter, you have to go for forewarming process, condensing will be done. And when you are using or producing whole milk product or having some amount of fat in it, in that case, you have to homogenize it. Then preheating at 74 to 85 degrees centigrade, drum drying will be done. And thereafter, packaging and subsequently storage at room temperature of these products will be done for. And thereafter, it will be transported to the different distributor or relator for further usage. So now the heat treatment requirements of these products. So generally, high temperature short time, that is heat temperature 72 degrees centigrade for 15 seconds, is applied, followed by rapid cooling to below 10 degrees centigrade we are using in dairy industry. But in case of continuous system, or you can say the flask pasteurization system, it is mainly preferred. And in case of ultra high temperature treatment, 149.5 degrees centigrade for 1 second or 93.4 degrees centigrade for 3 seconds people are using. It all depends upon the characteristic you want in your final product and where you are going to use that final product. Now, what is happening or what will be the effect of heat treatment on different type of microorganisms? What is happening in that? The condition or the temperature you are giving during the heat treatment, that will destroy all pathogens. It will inactivate all sort of enzymes which is already liberated in the system. And at the same time, it will activate sulfhydryl group that will work as an antioxidant in your product. And it is generally observed that if you are using HTST method, you can produce a better powder quality. And at the same time, it has been observed that deaeration of milk before heating protects vitamin D content present in your final product. So first of all, you have to go for condensing process. You have to raise the total solid level in your product. So what is there when you are collecting your milk? In it has been observed that generally 9% of total solid present in skim milk, or when you are using whole milk, about 13% of total solid is there in the system, and you have to go up to 45 to 52% total solid level. And this can be achieved by boiling your milk inside Calandria or multi-effect evaporator. So what is happening in that? Your milk will be passing through a vertical tubes, and at the same time, whatever water present in the system, a good percentage of that water will be evaporated, and the vapor produced in the system, that will be collected in vapor separator, and ultimately it will be compressed mechanically or thermally for further use in next effect evaporator. So it is just to economize the total process, and whatever heat generated from first effect, that will be generated in terms of vapor, that will be utilized in the second effect evaporator. So more than 85% of water you can remove in evaporator. And nowadays, modern plants are using up to 7 effect for maximizing energy efficiency. So you must have studied all these things in engineering courses. But here I just want to give you the process diagram of manufacturing these products, just to understand the microbiological significance of different stages of manufacturing. So what is generally happening, what type of severity of heat we are applying during different stages, and what will be the effect of these treatments on different type of microorganisms, either present initially or it will gain entry into the system as a contaminant. So what is happening in condensing? Milk is concentrated to 40 to 50% level, and for roller drying to only 33 to 35% level. So highly concentrated milk will form a thick layer on the roller and create difficulties during automation, which inhibits further drying process. So automatically, if you are choosing this spray drying process, the concentration level you require is different, that is 40 to 50% level. And if you are using roller drying process, especially for manufacturing of infant food or different kind of baby foods, you have to concentrate it up to 32 to 35% level, just for getting maximum effectiveness effect of heating system. So after condensing, you have to go for homogenization. Why people are using this process? It is just to prevent creaming or the rising of fat to the top of the container of milk, wherever you are keeping your milk after reconstitution or at before feeding inside your drying chamber. You are keeping it in a balanced tank, or you can say a storage tank. And if you are not giving this homogenization treatment, what will happen? Some amount of fat will be separated out because of the gravitational difference of different component, and automatically you will have to face a lot of problem. And the process of this homogenization permanently emulsifies the fine fat globules by a method that pumps milk under high pressure. You have already idea about the homogenization process, what people are doing and what are the effect of giving this particular treatment. You have to distribute and you have to break down your fat in a smaller size, and especially you can reduce the fat globule size to 1:10 of their original. So what will be the effect of this? It will result in the milk that maintain more uniform composition with improved body and take share. At the same time, you will get a whiter appearance, richer flavor, and you will get, if you produce curd with this, it will be more digestible. So these are the properties you can achieve by going or by giving this homogenization treatment to your product. Thereafter, you have to go for heating before entering the drying chamber. It is whatever concentrated milk you have produced or condensed milk you have produced by using multiple evaporator or some kind of drying system. Milk will be fed directly in the system, and due to this, what is happening before feeding into the dryer, it should be heated. Why it is done? It is just to reduce the viscosity and to increase the energy available for drying purposes. And thereafter, air filtration is also very important. Whatever air going inside the chamber after heating with steam, that should be filtered. Otherwise, it will add a number of different kind of contaminating microorganisms. Air filter is used to prevent contamination due to the dust or any other particulate matters. Then feed pump is very important. After homogenization or proper heating, feed pump is there in the system. Generally, 3-piston pump is used with a pressure up to 300 to 400 bar is used for pumping your condensed milk inside drying chamber. So what is happening in a spray drying process? So you all have idea about the method. Generally, two methods are there for in a spray drying process: automation and pressure nozzle system. So automatically, it all depends upon the requirements of market. People are selecting the method. In case of pressure nozzle, people are using a pressure nozzle in which measure and orifice size is responsible for the distribution angle inside the spray drying chamber. And in the automation system, there is centrifugal disc is there that will responsible for creating or producing milk droplets, and that for and it will use for feeding inside the spray drying chamber. And the size of droplets is in between 10 to 200 micrometer, and the maximum, and you can say the average size is in between 40 to 80 micrometer. What is happening when you are producing a smaller droplet size? It will result in higher surface area, and this will help in drying. If you are keeping or you have not adjusted your visor as well as orifice in your pressure nozzle system, or if you have, if you are using high concentrated feeding material, that is your condensed milk, automatically large droplets will be formed, and during the heating process, the inside or inner portion of that droplet will remain moist, and there may be chances of some number of microbes to survive in that condition. And whenever you will go for reconstitution process, that will again start creating abnormal condition to your final product. So now something about drying chamber. What is happening in that? What is the inlet temperature range and what is the outlet temperature range, and at what pressure people are feeding their condensed milk inside the chamber? So you can see here, inlet air temperature is 130 to 200 degrees centigrade. At the same time, outlet air temperature is 65 to 90 degrees centigrade, and automation pressure is 150 to 300. Co-current flow of hot air is preferred generally in a spray drying process. So just by controlling the size of the droplets, the air temperature and the air flow is present in the system. And what is happening with this? It is generally possible to evaporate almost all the moisture while exposing the solid to relatively low temperatures. External hammers are generally used just for hammering processes, whatever powder particles are deposited on the side of the wall of that drying chamber, that can be removed from that surfaces, and automatically you can get a good product. Just, and it is done generally for avoiding repeated heating of your deposited powder particles. Thereafter, one or two cyclone separators are there in the system, and its number will depend upon the size of your drying unit. So the principle of these cyclone separator is mainly based on the centrifugal force exerted on a particle, and it separates particle based on their density. Fines are sent forward to the filters. So what is happening in that? A very high centrifugal force is applied in the system, and whatever powder, smaller particles of powder go through the exhaust fan, exhaust side, that will be connected in this cyclone separator, and ultimately it will go for further filtering and bagging process. So this is a diagram of a spray drying system. This is multiple effect evaporator. Milk concentrate will be formed, and that this will go inside the spray drying chamber through this pressure nozzle or automation system. So ultimately powder will be formed, and in some cases you have to go for fluidized bed drying process. This is also a different type of drying unit. So just by going through, you can at least idea about the manufacturing process. These are the multiple effect evaporator, and ultimately here homogenization will be done, and thereafter the condensed milk will go inside this chamber. This is fluidized bed dryer, and bag filters are here, and ultimately it will go in the packing unit for packing in different sizes depending upon the consumer's need. It is in this figure I have tried to give you the idea about the fluidized bed process. What is happening in that? Simply agglomeration process is there. Tray, one a big size tray is there. Is sprinkling of good quality water is there in the system, and because of the vibration, powder particles will start agglomerating, and thereafter again drying of these particles will be done. It will improve the solubility as well, instantizing properties of your milk. So just by going this additional treatment, you can improve the overall quality of your powder. And if you are not using good quality of water for moistening the your milk, your dried powder, it will add some number of contaminating microorganisms, and ultimately problem will be created, and it will carry whatever product you will prepare, that will carry some amount of contaminants. Sometimes it will carry some number of pathogenic type of microorganisms, and ultimately it will create abnormal condition. In roller dryer, what we are doing, it involves direct contact of a layer of concentrated milk with the hot surface of rotating roller or drums. The drum body of the drum dryer is heated on the inside by steam, and feed used for roller drying contains, I have already told you that whatever feeding you will done, you generally people are using, in some cases people are using this concentration level 45% to 50% level. And depending on the design of drum dryer, the product is applied continuously as a thin film at the bottom or top of the main drum. Here you can see a figure of double drum drying system. Vapor hood is there, feed pump is here, and just in between these two roller drums, you have to apply your concentrated milk. So a fine film, it is rotating like this, and a fine film will be formed on the surface of these drums. And direct heating will be done, and a knife is there in the system that will remove all the powder particles, dried powder particles, and the powder particles will be collected in a tray, and ultimately it will go for further packaging and distribution purposes. The whole dried mill will be removed from the surface with the help of this knife, and that will be collected in a tray fixed in the bottom of that machine, and ultimately it will go for further packaging. So packaging and storage is also very important in case of milk powder. It is generally packed into either plastic lined multi-wall bags or airtight bulk bins. And in case of whole milk powder, it is often packed under nitrogen gas just to protect the original quality and just to protect your final product from oxidation, and at the same time, for maintaining its flavor and extending its shelf life, you have to use or you have to utilize this nitrogen packing system, especially for whole milk powder. So packaging is chosen to provide a barrier to moisture, oxygen, and light. So whatever condition you are creating by different kind of packaging material, that must protect your product from moisture, oxygen level, and light. Bags generally consist of several layers of to provide a strength and necessary barrier properties. And what is happening in case of retail milk powder? It is usually packed in tin containers. So agglomeration of milk powder, I have already told you the process, what is involved in manufacturing of agglomeration. So now something about the microbiology of dried milk. So roller dried milk, because in roller dried milk, whatever condensed milk you are applying in the system, that will directly come in contact of heating system. So in that case, a lower count, you will get a lower count that is approximately 1000 per gram. While in case of low heat spread dried powder, the count will go from few thousand to 1 million. So variation in count is mainly because of two regions, degree of contamination and different in temperature employed at different stages of processing. What is happening? So first of all, right from beginning, I'm repeatedly told you people that for any product, for manufacturing any product, one must have to minimize the bacterial load at the time of production, at the time of transportation, and thereafter when you are collecting your raw milk, that must maintain a good temperature, that you have to keep it below 4 degrees centigrade. And what type of treatment and what type of hygienic condition you are giving during those places, that will dictate the quality of your final product. And at the same time, on the basis of the quality parameters you have tested, you have to select a particular time temperature combination during the processing. So that will dictate the type of microorganism in final product. So microbes such as Aspergillus, Bacillus, Enterococcus, Micrococcus, Mucor, Penicillium, Rhizopus, Streptococcus can cause spoilages in dairy dried milk powder. So how it can create abnormal condition? If the number of these microbes is very high, and if you have not maintained good condition during the manufacturing process, so what are the vulnerable points? That is very important. In short, I just want to give you people idea that what is happening after condensing process. We are keeping your that condensed milk in a storage tank at a temperature range of 50 to 55. And that temperature range is very suitable for the growth and activity of a number of different kind of microorganisms. If you are not going for proper cleaning of that vat at regular interval, whatever residual amount of condensed milk present on the side wall of that that will act as a seeding material, and that will act as a contaminating source of contamination. And ultimately, there may be chances of presence of some number of Escherichia coli, Listeria monocytogenes, Salmonella and Shigella. And ultimately, if they survive in the drying process and automatically you are restricting the moisture level, you will get a good quality product. And the condition you are maintaining after drying process will not allow the growth and activity of these microbes because the reduced water activity level and low moisture level. But whenever you are going for reconstitution process, these microbes will start creating abnormal condition, and ultimately it will create problem. Now, Salmonella species, then Staphylococcus aureus, thereafter Listeria monocytogenes, Bacillus species, and Enterobacters are also showed their presence, and they all are responsible for creating different type of spoilages problem, and at the same time they are responsible for transferring some kind of diseases to human being. So you have to have a good control throughout during manufacturing operation. Whatever milk you are receiving, that must be of good quality. Whatever treatment you are giving, that depends upon the selection of treatment, or severity of heat treatment depends upon the chances of entering of different contaminants during the process. Accordingly, you have to choose the whole process, whole processing treatment, and just by maintaining all these, you can prepare a very good quality of final product. So this is all about today's lecture.